The triple whopper of rockets launches to the sun, now on kNews. Hey guys, Sweating Luke is here. Welcome to kNews, and as always, a big shout out to you, my kNews boosters on Patreon. Thanks for your trust. By triple whopper, I mean the United Launch Alliance's Delta IV Heavy, but that's not the only rocket, so here a quick summary for week 32, 2018. Well, this is a rather short summary because it is only one rocket besides Delta, which was SpaceX Falcon 9 on August 7th from Cape Canaveral. As you can hopefully see, it was the first used Block 5 variant launching again. The booster brought the Bangabandhu 1 satellite to space in May earlier this year, so SpaceX is getting faster and faster reusing them. They are still far away from reusing them on a daily basis, but better safe than sorry. Even though these boosters are meant to be reused at least 10 times, the first ones will be carefully checked in between flights to be really sure their part weir calculations are right. On top, the booster is as usual the upper stage, which pushed a communications satellite to space called Telstar 18 Vantage, operated by Telsat and built by SSL. It will be put on a geosynchronous transfer orbit and reach its destination at 138 degrees on its own after it has separated from the carrier vehicle. As you can hopefully tell from the map, the satellite will be able to cover Asia with its broadcasting services, but also Hawaii all the way across the ocean. If you want to see the launch livestream or replay for that matter, you can as always simply check the info box. And the main launch I want to cover in this video is the ULA's Delta IV Heavy, which has a rather rare appearance in my video since it only launches once per year or so. It's currently scheduled to launch on Saturday, August 11th from Cape Canaveral as well. The Heavy variant uses two common booster cores as strap-ons and one in the center, although I'm sure they are quite different even though they look similar. On top is its upper stage, carrying probably the hottest satellite ever to launch, the Parker Solar Probe, named after the scientist Eugene Parker, who had some great ideas on how the sun's corona might work. Parker followed the suggestion of a German scientist working at plasma physics, Ludwig Biermann. Is that the coolest name or what? Biermann thought about comet trails that always point outwards of the sun and suggested that the sun must shoot out some kind of hydrogen plasma into space. Parker then theorized how this plasma hovering around the sun's atmosphere could be accelerated by the sun's strong magnetic fields. He showed mathematically how the magnetic field must look like in order to achieve that. I didn't have much time to go real deep into this, guys, but I think he was right. However, please don't quote me on that. The Parker Solar Probe will be shot towards Venus, where it will receive 7 gravity assists over the next 7 years. Its final orbit will be closer to the sun than anything human-made has ever reached, traveling at nearly 200 kilometers per second. The closest approach will be approximately 6.2 million kilometers away from the sun's hot outer plasma layers. This plunge's goal or mission is to get never-before insights into how exactly the sun's corona, aka plasma gun, works to confirm the predictions. Another very important fact: Corona is a Mexican beer, and the guy working on it was Biermann. Draw whatever conclusions you want from that, guys. Cheers. But back to Parker Lewis, Parker Booth, who can't lose. What? I mean the Parker Solar Probe. What I try to say is the most heat the probe has to withstand comes off the sun directly and surprisingly not the millions of degrees hot corona. That's because the corona is like Earth's hot thermosphere, not very dense, and the few particles per cubic meter are not enough to heat up the probe, despite them being incredibly hot. The sun's electromagnetic radiation, however, that also warms up our planet, reaches 500 times the energy at its closest point compared to that on Earth per square meter. This means the probe's advanced carbon composite heat shield will have to keep 1400 degrees Celsius or 2500 degrees Fahrenheit away from the vehicle. That's roughly the heat you'd get surfing on molten lava, guys. It's crazy. But the most astonishing part is not actually the fact that the heat shield doesn't melt away, that's relatively simple, but that the probe attached to it can operate at almost room temperature. This means almost zero energy is transferred to the back of it, which is quite the achievement, I would say. The computer components and sensors could otherwise not work properly. To give you a little overview about what it is the shield protects, the instrumentation on board, besides communication, computation and energy systems, consists of 4 major investigations, as they call it. First, the fields experiment. These are the antennas sticking out of the probe, which will measure electromagnetic stuff like voltages, magnetic fields and so on. Next is the integrated science investigation of the Sun, or ISIS. Maybe not the best acronym. You know what? Let's put a sun symbol in the middle. Much better. Yep, believe it or not, but that's exactly what NASA did. Anyways, this is a sensor array that will detect and measure the energies of the solar wind's particles like electrons and protons. Third is the wide field imager for solar probe, or WISPER. These are telescope cameras which will take images of the sun's corona, as the sun itself, of course, is shielded by the heat shield like a constant mini eclipse. And lastly, there is the solar wind electrons, alphas and protons investigation, or SWEEP for short. It will, similarly to ISIS, study the coronal particles using multiple sensors to measure their velocity, density and temperature. The Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory dedicated a whole website to this mission, so if you want to know much more in-depth information, feel free to visit it. It's packed with images and insights. I can also recommend to have a look at Parker's old paper on the sun's corona. The Delta IV heavy launch itself will take 43 minutes, beginning with the mighty rocket lifting off the pad. The first major event will then occur at 4 minutes into the flight, which is of course the booster separation. Now don't confuse this with the Falcon Heavy. These boosters won't land and there will be no camera streaming the descent, sadly. However, there will be cameras on board the main vehicle, so it's definitely worth to watch the live stream, and I will also link it in the info box. The first stage separation of the core booster is about 1.5 minutes later, followed by 3 burns of the upper stage. It will push itself and the probe on an escape trajectory from Earth, as mentioned, towards Venus, where its 7-year long journey begins. The Parker Solar Probe will do a total of 21 orbits around the Sun, coming closer and closer with each gravity assist. However, I think all orbits are somewhat valuable, so we don't have to wait for 7 years before the first data will arrive. In fact, the first close encounter at its periapsis will occur just 3 months after launch, by the end of the year. The downlink from the satellite is with a maximum of 0.5 megabits per second, surprisingly high, but of course depends on the distance between the probe and Earth. The data will be received by NASA's Deep Space Network, which consists of 3 giant antennas spread around the globe. Placed 120 degrees apart, they can keep continued contact to everything beyond 30,000 kilometers, unless of course it's blocked by a celestial body. Okay, that shall conclude this episode, and I hope to see you in the next one if you like. Feel free to share your thoughts in the comments and don't forget to subscribe. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.